In 2013, a mysterious video of a woman seemingly possessed by a ghost went viral. Many were convinced the building's creepy history was to blame, until a pile of new evidence pointed towards foul play and even a cover-up.
Mysteries like this should not remain unsolved.
Before we get into the details, here's a recap of what allegedly happened. On January 26, 2013, 21-year-old Canadian tourist Elisa Lam traveled to Los Angeles. 2 days later, she checked into the Cecil, a 600-room hotel that was built in 1924. It was widely known as having a creepy history of murders and suicides, and is said to be one of the most haunted places on Earth. Elisa stayed in a shared room, but was later moved to a private one after her roommates complained about her odd behavior. On January 31st, 2013, a hotel worker saw Elisa standing outside the hotel. They turned out to be one of the few people who last saw her alive. Among the few includes Katie Orphan, the manager of the last bookstore, who described Elisa as outgoing, lively, and friendly. She remembers Elisa buying gifts for her family, and was concerned that they would be too heavy to carry around as she traveled. While the media reported Katie as the only person who recalled speaking to Elisa that day, it turns out she wasn't the only one. Tosh Berman, an LA native, was browsing the bookstore when he saw Elisa holding a stack of records. She asked him about his album preferences, and then went on to talk about herself throughout their entire conversation. At first, he found her appealing, but then her behavior made him feel uncomfortable. He thought it was alarming that she would be so open with a complete stranger. On February 1st, 2013, Elisa was supposed to check out of the hotel, but was nowhere to be found. Her parents, who she contacted daily, didn't receive any calls or texts from her. They became worried and reported her missing. Afterwards, police searched all over the hotel for her, but found no traces. On February 7th, 2013, the LAPD held a press conference about her strange disappearance.
We're seeking to get this photo out so we can find Elisa.
A week later, they still had no leads. So they released an unusual video of Elisa in an elevator. Elisa can be seen pushing buttons for multiple floors, peeking out of the open doors, hopping in and out of the elevator, and waving her arms in strange movements with her fingers splayed. Many wondered, was she sleepwalking, possessed, or drugged? On February 19th, 2013, hotel guests started noticing something strange about the amenities. The tap water oozed out of the faucet as thick, brownish-red sludge. Santiago Lopez, a maintenance worker, decided to inspect the 8-foot-tall water tanks on the rooftop. He discovered one of the lids was opened and assumed the police mistakenly left it that way after searching for Elisa. To close the lid, he had to climb a 10-foot ladder to the top of the water tank. When he looked down inside, something caught his eye, a color where there should be none, the color red. When he took a closer look, he discovered something even more shocking. 12 inches from the top was a naked body floating face up. Their clothes, including a red hoodie, were found beside them. The body was later identified as Elisa. She somehow gained access to the rooftop without a key card, which didn't trigger the working alarm, and jumped into the tank by pushing aside a 20-pound lid. How she got to the rooftop still remains a mystery. On June 20th, 2013, a coroner ruled Elisa's death as an accident due to drowning and other significant conditions, including bipolar disorder. Her toxicology report revealed that while she didn't take all of her medications recently, proper amounts of it were found in her blood. It also revealed that no illicit drugs or alcohol were found in her body. Many questioned if Elisa's bipolar disorder and her choice to not take all of her medications recently triggered a psychotic episode. They also questioned if it led to her strange behavior in the elevator and her decision to climb into the water tank. But again, it was reported that proper amounts of medication were found in her blood. In an online forum, a psychologist argued that her behavior in the video isn't particularly strange and doesn't seem like a psychotic break. Another commenter highlighted that even if she did experience a psychotic break, it might have not led to her drowning. Instead, it could have just made her an easy target for predators. On September 19th, 2013, Elisa Lam's parents filed a wrongful death lawsuit against the Cecil. They claimed that the Cecil failed to inspect and seek out hazards that presented an unreasonable risk of danger to Elisa and to other guests. The Cecil argued it couldn't have reasonably foreseen that Elisa might enter one of the water tanks, and that because of how she got there still remains a mystery, no liability could be assigned for failing to prevent that. In 2015, a judge dismissed the lawsuit. Now we're closer to getting to the new evidence, allegations, and disclosures. But first, let's talk about some of the strange coincidences. The first coincidence involves a horror film. In 2002, a Japanese horror film named Dark Water was released. The name of the daughter is Cecilia, which is phonetically close to Cecil. 3 years later, a Hollywood remake was released starring Jennifer Connelly. The name of her character is Dahlia, which reminds many of the Black Dahlia. The Black Dahlia is a nickname given to Elizabeth Short, a woman who stayed at the Cecil just before she was murdered in 1947. In the Hollywood remake, the characters resemble Elisa in a few ways. Dahlia's daughter Cece wears a red jacket that resembles Elisa's hoodie and drowns in a rooftop water tank. There are also scenes of characters pressing buttons in an elevator while being watched on surveillance screens. The framing of these videos appears to be the exact same setup as Elisa's video. The second coincidence involves a test. Around the time of Elisa's death, LA was facing its largest tuberculosis outbreak in over a decade, which affected thousands of people close to the Cecil. Medical examiners tested Elisa for the disease by performing a test called Lam-ELISA. While it's an acronym, the test was developed by a group of scientists from the University of British Columbia, the same university that Elisa attended. The third coincidence involves the scene of the crime. When the fire department removed Elisa from the water tank, photos were taken that showed graffiti on the rooftop. The tags include the Latin phrase, fecto per summa, which means in fact she was a or was the best. How did Elisa and this person access the rooftop? Cecil's management made statements insisting it wasn't accessible, which became legally critical when Elisa's parents filed a lawsuit. What's even more strange is that on that day of Elisa's disappearance, she posted this note on her Tumblr account. Again, it was odd how men used that word to demean women when it was the only part of a woman they valued. The fourth coincidence involves the last bookstore. The registrant privacy company that manages its website happens to have a P.O. box in Burnaby, a suburb in Vancouver where Elisa lived. In Google Maps, the P.O. box is actually located within the Forest Lawn Cemetery where Elisa was buried. If you're already creeped out by these strange coincidences, it's about to get even worse. Now, we're moving on to the new evidence, allegations, and disclosures that point towards foul play and even a cover-up. Some of the case's biggest mysteries and questions haven't been explained or answered. In Santiago's sworn testimony in court, he claimed the rooftop alarm was working on the day he discovered Elisa's body. But according to Amy Price, Cecil's general manager, the alarm was never activated between January and February 2013. This contradicts the Cecil's previous statements that the rooftop wasn't accessible. YouTuber Kay Tang, who traveled from Hong Kong to LA to investigate, refutes their statement by showing how easy it is to access the rooftop. In a video where he documents his steps, he avoids the stairs used by employees to reach the alarmed locked door and climbs the 14th floor fire escape to access the rooftop. This is just one of the many possibilities of a perjured testimony. When Santiago found Elisa's body, he claimed that the water tank's lid was open. But according to Andrew Smith, one of the first officers on the scene, the lid was closed entirely. That makes more sense, because how could Elisa move a heavy metal lid over herself as she climbed into the tank with no footrests? Strangely, after Santiago gave his sworn testimony in court, he was paid a large sum of money to move out of LA and back to Mexico. The source who shared this information was Demique Lopez, Santiago's half-brother, who didn't even know he'd left until much later. Was Santiago paid to say the lid was open? Also, why did he leave in such a hurry? Unfortunately, that's not the only payout allegation. One day after Elisa was discovered, The Cecil owners closed a multi-million deal with CBRE, one of the largest real estate firms in the world. Some wondered if this deal was the reason why there was a delay in finding Elisa, mainly because news of the case would lead to calling it off. YouTuber John Lorden pointed out how easy it may have been for the owners to silence employees.
You have an employee that we now know has been working at this building for 30 years. The guy's whole life is literally tied up with this building. How hard would it be for someone that has a vested interest to convince someone that is a manager of the maintenance department, we need for this body to not be found. We've got big things happening in the company. We can't have this get out.
There are many accusations of creepy, predatory, and even criminal acts by hotel employees. According to Jake Anderson, an investigative journalist who wrote a book about the case, several Yelp reviews mention this kind of behavior, specifically from the security guards. Tanya Danielle, a former hotel guest, reached out to Andrew to share her experience in an email. She said she was assigned to a room with broken locks on a deserted floor and had a strange encounter with an employee in the elevator. He offered to give me a tour of the hotel, and the predatory glint in his eye seemed unmistakable. I've met my share of creepy guys, but this man was different. He just seemed too polished and too sure of himself. I had the sense that he could inflict his will on anybody. One woman who lived in the Cecil and asked to remain anonymous reported that employees have used their master key to enter rooms and sexually assault women. Another woman named Tina supported her claim and said that many of them, including maintenance workers, have assaulted tenants. The police investigation was flawed or negligent at best, corrupt at worst. When the LAPD searched the Cecil twice, they found no traces of Elisa. They even claimed to have searched every nook and cranny with the canine unit, including the rooftop. Since they underlooked the scene of the crime, they failed to find or neglected to disclose critical forensic evidence like blood, DNA, and drug remnants. They also didn't consult their psychology department about the nature of bipolar disorder and Elisa's behavior in the video. What's even more shocking is that their coroner's department noted anal bleeding in their autopsy, and yet they didn't bother to process a rape kit. When the LAPD released Elisa's video, many questioned why, since it didn't help to identify potential suspects. Others questioned why the timestamp was blurred out and started taking a closer look at the video. YouTuber Cody Fry suspected it was tampered with and that it appeared to be slowed down, so he created a side-by-side comparison of the original and a sped-up version, which looks more natural and makes Elisa's behavior look less bizarre. He claims that about a minute of the video was removed and suspects that it was slowed down to stretch the time code back to its original length. Several people agreed and questioned why the video was tampered with. Someone killed her. The footage originally released by the police was heavily doctored. Why blur out the timestamp? Why slow it down? Why cut out a whole minute off the video? The hotel did everything they could to remove the killer from being seen. Why wouldn't the elevator door close? Elisa was clearly avoiding someone and trying to get away in fear, and the killer kept the door open from outside. Just look at her face. She wasn't hallucinating. There was someone there. And in a cliche fashion that the movie Dark Water showed, the death of a woman inside a water tank. Only the killer would have done that. This video clearly shows the security footage was manipulated in some way. The question is why? This places suspicion on the police, investigators, and the security personnel of the hotel. Why did they manipulate the footage? That is the question we should be asking, not theorizing about ghosts. Elisa deserves justice and answers. This was done deliberately to alter the perception of actions, to make it look like she was having an episode. What makes Cody's claims more convincing is that Andrew's book reveals that LAPD hired two private investigators to work on Elisa's case. They told a contact that they believed the video was tampered with and that an officer was involved. They also said the hotel was involved in buying out the LAPD to drop the case. Now here's a disturbing new disclosure that may have helped to identify potential suspects. In 2015, the CBC reported that there was a second video that the police hid. Detective Wallace Tennell admitted the video shows Elisa walking into the hotel with two men who hand her a box. Afterwards, she walks up to the elevator. The men are never seen again. Many wondered if they were ever questioned by the police and why they never released the video. They also started to question the existence of a third surveillance video. In an LAist interview, Pedro Tover, Cecil's chief engineer, noted four ways to get onto the roof: three fire escapes and one staircase from the 14th floor. This means Elisa may have entered the rooftop from the staircase, and yet the police never disclosed or shared a video from the 14th floor. Several independent coroners have noted inconsistencies and flaws in Elisa's cause of death. Dr. Hisarat explained that most victims of drowning are found face down with large amounts of fluid in their lungs, but Elisa was found face up, and there wasn't any water in her lungs. He added that while there's around 15% of dry drowning cases, the body does everything it can to get air, leading to water in the stomach. But in Elisa's case, there wasn't any water in her stomach either. He said it's highly likely she was suffocated by someone who threw her body in the water tank, and that the anal bleeding could be from trauma from anal sex. This could have been determined if a rape kit was processed and if Elisa was tested for date rape drugs. Instead, she was only tested for recreational drugs. Last but not least, the coroner's department took an unusual amount of time, 6 months instead of 6 to 9 weeks, to declare Elisa's cause of death. They also crossed out and changed their conclusion. A few years later, the chief medical examiner who released Elisa's autopsy was sued in court and charged with falsifying an autopsy and misclassifying a descendant's cause of death. This is the story of how a young woman was mysteriously found in a water tank who may never receive the justice she deserves. What do you think happened to Elisa? Should the LAPD reopen the case? Let us know in the comments below.